Well, now we gotta go this way too, because I turned it on this way.
So it's working?
Yeah. Thank you. Chiefs.
A little game happening or something like that. I know my kids really want the Chiefs to win. Why? Because they're huge Chiefs fans, right? There you go. I want to get off of that parade. So a little prayer for that, Isaiah. Our call to worship is coming from Psalms 119, starting in verse 146. I cry out to you, save me, and I will keep your testimonies. I rise before the dawning of the morning and cry for help. Are you sign language? That's amazing. I didn't know you could do that. Okay. I hope in your word, my eyes are awake in the night watching that I may meditate on your word. Hear my voice according to your loving kindness, O Lord. Provide me according to your justice. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord God, let us today be a day of worship and joy with you. Let us look to you for all things. Let us know you, Lord God. I praise you and I thank you.
Amen.
They don't want to touch man. Like, look how far the doctors, teenagers, sit way over the other side of the right? I understand. I get it. So I'm enjoying myself in this part of it up. That's my third kid. So if you look at your bulletin, we have quite a few announcements. We have the Lenten luncheons that are beginning the 22nd of February. That's Ash Wednesday. And what are those? Those are times where we come together to eat and kind of fellowship. This is your bulletin.
is 17 June. It's Leavenworth Week. This year happens to be our 50th anniversary of OCM Ministry of Fort Leavenworth. So we're going to celebrate that a little bit while we're there. But our speaker is Chaplain Kuhnman, who's our garrison chaplain. He will have ditched us before many by then, but we're going to bring him back in, and it's going to be excellent. So if you are interested in this at all, please come find Christina or I after church. We'll be back there. In addition, I'd like to invite you to bring out an open house at our house. We'll give you the address there. It's the next Sunday, 3 to 5. Did I say that right? Yeah, 1579 for the Army Tights. At our house in Lansing, we'd love to have you come with an opportunity to talk a little more. One thing I'm going to tell you before I leave, this is not a chapel program. There is a cost, there's a financial cost. We're happy to talk through that with you after this. It is competitive with anything you might do on a vacation, and it is more fulfilling than going to Disney Park or something else. So, thank you so much. Please come talk to us if you're taking a little bit of your second. God bless you all and go Chiefs.
So let's please stand for our next vote. Now, we already have a question back there, but if that's something you actually want to look into as well, if you see that handsome man over there, yeah, pick one, right? And also the digital giving, if you are someone who can man, I'm sorry, guys. Digital giving is the QR code on the, in the middle bottom of the bulletin. So please join me in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, God Almighty, Lord, you made this world through your speech. So let there be light. Let there be heavens. Let there be ground. Let there be plants and animals. And then you molded us, Lord God, out of the dust, it says. You breathed life into us. And then when there was no helper, you made a helper. To commune with you in the garden. Lord, I pray. We gather in your name. It's like we're in the garden again in your midst. There's none high, there's none be ashamed for your grace, your Son Jesus Christ covers us. I pray for this world, Lord God, the world that you gave us, and said, be in my image. I pray for the churches right now gathering in your name that celebrate your resurrection, Jesus Christ. That's why we meet on Sunday to celebrate the tomb is empty. You're alive. Oh Lord, there's a lot of churches in the world right now that are meeting in secret, underground, smuggling Bibles to them. Lord, we pray that they will just continue to flourish. I pray for the American church, Lord God, though, that has become stale, maybe even cultural. Maybe it's lost its passion for you. Not all, but some. Lord, let us remember that we were made as a nation under God. Let us remember our tenets to be able to worship you in freedom. Lord, I pray for our leaders of this nation, the government, that you would be with them, to guide them, to direct them, that laws would be humane, that will be directed towards your greatness. Lord, I pray for this installation and this leaders as well. This is a place of leaders, where leaders are trained. But Lord, let them also be trained spiritually. Let them know you, Lord. Let us look to your way, the way you treated your team. Love, purpose, anger at times, but patience. We are all followers of you, Lord Jesus. I pray for this chapel, this community, the 8:30 and 11 o'clock service. Lord, let this be a vibrant church, not just a check, but a church. I pray for Mark and these who will come up here soon to deliver your message. Speak through him, use him, fill in his gaps with your grace. Let him speak your words. Motivate us to action. Lord, I pray for the children shortly will be the children's church. I pray for the volunteers and teachers, Lord, that are born into the next generation, Lord God. The generation of youth that will grow up, speak your name. Statistics say church attendance is down. I pray for our children. Because we're calling them to be missionaries. Truths, let's go to your name. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
have a Bible, I invite you to open it to Mark chapter 7, reading verses 1 through 23. The kids actually can go with Keith and Carl in the back. They're part of our dynamic worship team for our kids. So thank you, Keith and Carl, and all the volunteers today. We're going to be in Mark chapter 7, verses 1 through 23. If you've been with us a few weeks, we're looking at the Gospel of Mark. We're looking at Jesus as our King and the kind of kingdom that he has come to bring. And all of Mark really tells us in these various different passages that Jesus is a different kind of king, bringing a different kind of kingdom than maybe he would naturally expect. He's obviously a king that has a far different kind of power than we do, as we saw last week when he multiplied the loaves of bread and fishes. But this week what we'll see is he really has a different set of kingdom values than maybe what everyone else expects for him to value. And we need this instruction. We need to know, what is it that our King truly values, truly requires of us? Because left to our own devices, in our own understanding, we would probably just take the easy road and we would find ourselves wanting. So I encourage you, if you have a Bible, to follow along with me. Mark chapter 7, verses 1 through 23. Hear the word of the Lord. Now when the Pharisees gathered to him with some of the scribes who had come from Jerusalem, they saw that some of his disciples ate with hands that were defiled, that is, unwashed. But the Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they wash their hands properly, holding to the tradition of the elders. And when they came from the marketplace, they do not eat unless they wash. And there are many other traditions that they observe, such as the washing of cups and pots and copper vessels and dining couches. And the Pharisees and the scribes asked him, "Why do your disciples not walk according to the tradition of the elders, but eat with defiled hands?" And he said to them, "Well did Isaiah prophesy of you hypocrites, as it is written, 'The people honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men.' You leave the commandment of God and hold to the tradition of men." And he said to them, "You have a fine way of rejecting the commandment of God in order to establish your tradition. For Moses said, 'Honor your father and your mother,' and whoever reviles father or mother must surely die. But you say, 'If a man tells his father or his mother, whatever you would have gained from me is Corban, that is, given to God,' you no longer permit him to do anything for his father or mother, thus making void the word of God by your tradition that you have handed down, and many such things you do." And he called the people to him again and said to them, "Hear me, all of you, and understand. There is nothing outside a person that by going into him can defile him. But the things that come out of a person are what defile him. And when he had entered the house and left the people, his disciples asked him about the parable. And he said to them, 'Then are you also without understanding? Do you not see that whatever goes into a person from outside cannot defile him, since it enters not his heart, but his stomach, and is expelled? Thus he declared all things clean.' And he said, 'What comes out of the person is what defiles him. For from within, out of the heart of man, comes evil thoughts, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, coveting, wickedness, deceit, sensuality, envy, slander, pride, foolishness. All these evil things come from within, and they defile a person.'" I invite you to join me in prayer. Almighty God, we come before you this morning, and we are grateful for this account that instructs us what it is that King Jesus really values. And Lord, we need your work of your Holy Spirit within us. Like, my words are not enough to even shape or form my own heart, let alone the hearts of my brothers and sisters who are gathered here this morning. So we pray, text and use it to expose our hearts, and use it to convict our hearts, and use it to console our hearts. And all for the glory of Jesus we pray. Amen. The church is full of hypocrites. That's a lot of people's common objection to why they don't want to be involved in Christianity. They don't want to be involved in the church. You've probably heard that 100 times before. And do we really have, fault people for saying that? I mean, if you look at all of the public scandals alone that are within the church, it might be a valid concern. It might be a valid complaint. And those aren't even all the private scandals. How do I know that the church is full of hypocrites? Because I'm up here talking to you. So you obviously let one inside, okay? But even Dr. James Kennedy, if you guys know of him, he said this, for these people who always say, well, the church is full of hypocrites, he responded to this objection by saying, well, there's always room for one more, right? I mean, that's what we say when we're trying to get on the 5-ton or the Bradley. There's always room for one more. There's always room for one more hypocrite. Welcome here in our ranks. He cautioned people that once they found the perfect church, that they probably ought not to join it because that would ruin the perfect church. We know in this passage, Jesus is calling out not just hypocrites, he's calling out hypocrisy. He says it in verse 6, well, did Isaiah prophesy of you hypocrites? Hypocrites are those who are just playing a role. They're a phony. You're just trying to act like a Christian. But Jesus goes on to not just point out the hypocrisy. He goes in to really give us the antidote for hypocrisy. And the antidote for hypocrisy is that our religious belief would not just be external, but that it would be internal. You see, the crux of the matter, the crux of the issue, is always an issue of the heart. Now, my mom has a very rare heart condition. It's called coronary arterial ectasia. Like 1 in 10,000 people have it. And what that means is, I'm not a doctor, but I did spend the night at a Holiday Inn last night because my wife and I were fighting. Okay, that's just a joke. We weren't fighting. I didn't sleep in the Holiday Inn. Okay. But so coronary arterial ectasia is when like your coronary arteries look like sausage links that are snapped together. And so that's obviously going to, you know, affect the circulation in your heart. Now, it presents like a normal heart attack, right? The symptoms of it look just like a normal heart attack. But the doctors have to go a lot deeper, a truer, fuller diagnosis, a lot of specialized tests to truly fully understand what was at issue. And I think that's somewhat what Jesus is doing in this passage. Jesus isn't just diagnosing symptoms, but he's going to the cause. He's going to the root of the issue. And so really we're going to look at this passage today, and as we look at this idea of hypocrisy, hypocrisy is really rooted in diagnostic error. We'll get to that. And then we'll look at, there's a danger if you have a diagnostic error. And then finally, we'll look at it, what does this passage truly teach us about the person of Jesus and the nature of Jesus? So this first point, that hypocrisy is really this idea of diagnostic error. And we see that because the Pharisees and the scribes, they care way too much. They are far more concerned about external symptoms than they are about internal realities. They care more about the symptoms than they care about the root causes. You see, these Pharisees and scribes, they're coming from Jerusalem, the religious hub. And they're coming to, you know, kind of like, hey, Jesus, why don't you guys wash your hands like we do? And this isn't honest religious inquiry. This is them trying to discredit who Jesus is. And so in verse 2, verse 6, they point to this idea of hand washing leading to defilement. And defilement basically means filth and being unclean. And the Pharisees and the scribes rightly see this as important to God. The Old Testament reminds us, who can ascend the hill of the Lord to be with him? He who has clean hands and a pure heart. And so the Pharisees rightly recognize cleanliness is important to God, but they were more focused on external cleanliness than internal cleanliness. They're more focused on ritual cleanliness than moral cleanliness. And so Jesus points out their diagnostic error. In verse 15, he declares, it's not something outside of you that's going to make you unclean. And he unpacks this a little bit more in verses 20 and 21. He says, it's what comes out of the person, or what's inside the person. That's what makes him unclean. And he lists a lot of heart issues that we're going to get into a little bit later. So again, there is a diagnostic error by these Pharisees and scribes. But not only that, they have the complete wrong diagnostic standard. In verses 7 to 9, Jesus declares that they're going to wash their pots and pans because they've just been out there in that dirty, nasty, defiled, vile world. They want to be assured that none of that has gotten into them. So they had to wash everything. And in so doing, they're really rejecting God's authority. In their pride, they're establishing their rules as more important than God's authority. They're saying, we're the ones that can keep ourselves clean. Now, COVID taught us all to be very clean. Okay, right? I mean, wash your hands, all right, so you don't spread the COVID. But, you know, we may not necessarily look to religious standards, but a lot of times in our world, we kind of flip it. We think that the worldly standards are more authoritative than biblical standards. The world wants to say, hey, if you want to be right, you need to be tolerant. You need to be accepting. That's the standard that matters, as opposed to standards of true righteousness or true holiness. But sometimes in the church, we like to, in our contemporary Christian world, we like to church it up. We like to say, we like to add these standards. We like to impose these standards of Christian schooling and Christian music and Christian radio and Christian practices and Christian organizations and Christian whatever. And we add and we add and we add, trying to sometimes impress God, sometimes trying to impress others, sometimes trying to assuage or assure our guilty conscience. When we do that, we're going to the wrong standard. You see, when we look only at the symptoms, when we adhere to the wrong standards, it's somewhat akin to saying that SOPs trump Army regulation. It's somewhat akin to saying, like, well, state laws trump federal laws. It's somewhat akin to kids going to mom because they know mom's got this set of rules and dad has this other set of rules. Right? We pit these things against each other because we want to go to the one that's going to assure us of our own sense of rightness. misdiagnosis. In the United States alone, right, this idea of the danger of misdiagnosis, doctors' misdiagnosis cost about 40 to 80,000 lives a year. It costs our economy $750 billion each year. Well, there's also a great spiritual danger if we misdiagnose what the problem really is. There's a huge danger. And what this passage tells us is that the misdiagnosis, the danger of it, is it's rooted in our pride and in our presumption. It's rooted in this false notion that I can make myself clean before a holy and righteous God. It's a great danger. The greatest danger is that pride. It's that presumption that we all live in. Jonathan Edwards, one of the great early theologians, put it this way. He says, the first and worst cause of errors that abound in our day and age is spiritual pride. It is the chief inlet of smoke from a bottomless pit to darken the mind and mislead the judgment, and mislead our judgment. Spiritual pride is the main spring, or at least the main support of all other errors. Until this disease is cured, medicines are applied in vain to heal all other diseases. You see, Jesus begins to explain to the Pharisees about their hypocrisy, being rooted in their pride. This misdiagnosis about focusing on external rather than internal realities. And he says there's a great danger to this in verses 6 through 7. And he says it in this way. He says about their pride and their presumption that they are honoring God with their lips, but their hearts are far from God. He says, in vain are you worshiping me and honoring me. That worship is empty, meaningless, void if it's only external and it's not rooted in the internal. He's saying it's lip service. Don't we hate lip service? Don't we hate those leaders who just talk a good game but don't back it up with their actions? I had this boss when I was a brigade chaplain. My brigade, so he's a good man. But he found out I was a Kansas Jayhawks fan, right? And he's actually, his cousin is Bill Self's wife, Cindy Self. He promised me the world when he found out I was a Kansas basketball fan. He's like, Mark, we're going to go to this one, we're stationed at Fort Benning. We're going to go out to the field house when it's KU, Kentucky. After the game, we're going to go spend the night at Bill and Cindy Self's house, have breakfast with them in the morning. It's just going to be this great day. Never happens. Right? So he doesn't, you know, he doesn't, it's all lip service. He doesn't carry through with that one. But then he promises me, he's like, okay, Mark, I didn't get you on that one, but I'm going to get you a signed basketball from all the coaches and all the players, and we'll get that to you. Never happens. You know what we got out of that loss? We got a bunch of hand-me-down t-shirts, you know, from his older son to my younger son. That's all we got. All talk, no gain. All fart, no food. Whatever you want to call it, that's what it was. Okay? Lip service. Or maybe not lip service, like we talk about it this way in our day and age. Lipstick on a pig. Right? You heard that expression? You can put some lipstick, some, I don't know, CoverGirl, L'Oreal, Cindy Crawford lipstick. I don't know what. It's still a pig. You put earrings on it, eyeliner, it's still a pig. But we do the same things with God. We do the same thing. We try and approach God with all the externals. Oh, God, I'm doing this, and I'm not. Micah chapter 6, verses 6 through 8. What shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come with him with burnt offerings, with the best of my calves? Will the Lord be pleased with 10,000 rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn? That's pride and presumption. Lord, look at all the things that I'm going to do religiously to try and prove to you that I mean business with you. What is he saying now? What does the Lord require of you? It's all internal. Do justice. Love mercy. Walk humbly with your God. You see, lip service and lipstick on a pig is not just dangerous in our interactions with God, it's also dangerous with one another. That's what this whole Corbin thing is about, right? This whole idea of Corbin was this way in the Old Testament, like, okay, this is all the wealth that I have, but I'm designating this as Corbin. This is intended for religious purposes. All this wealth, I'm the one presuming and declaring it's for religious purposes. So I can just kind of hoard it to myself. And I don't even have to take care of mom and dad. And maybe we don't practice hoarding, but a lot of times we can get so consumed with our religious performance, our religious rituals, that we neglect the needs of others. I'm ashamed to say this. A lot of times I get up early because that's the only time it's quiet in my house. And if a kid comes down and interrupts my quiet time, like I'm like, you know, like, you can't interrupt my time with the Lord. This is my religious ritual. And I'm neglecting the needs of others. Out of my pride and my presumption. And so we have to be careful of this. Now, it's one thing for me to just talk about all of these realities, right? This is obviously what the scripture does. But I want to do more than that. I want us to check our own hearts. Because in the day-to-day busyness, in the day-to-day responsibilities and requirements that are on you, it's easy to neglect how is my own heart doing. And I know it's easy to do that because it happens to me as well. I remember when I was a ranger battalion chaplain in Savannah, Georgia. Man, I was so busy, and great things were happening spiritually. Religious things were happening. Great things were happening to people who fly. You know, I'm trying to be a good chaplain, so I go to my denominational training and everything like that. And, you know, just so I can prove that I'm a good PCA chaplain. And I go to this conference and this seminar about the health and heart of a pastor. And a pastor asks, he's like, I want to know how your heart's doing. I want to know how your heart's doing. And he asks this, yes, when was the last time you told Jesus that you loved him? And I couldn't remember. I couldn't remember. I was so busy, so doing important religious things, but I couldn't even remember when I told Jesus that I just loved him. You know, a couple of weeks ago, I had my colonoscopy. You know, I'm turning 50 this year, right? So, AKA Operation Roto-Rooter. Okay, so I know some of you are young and have the benefit of this, right? But the whole premise of the colonoscopy, right, is it's going to cleanse you out so that doctor can see inside of you to see if there's really disease in there. The doctor needs to cleanse you out before he sees if there's disease in there. So this is your little colonoscopy. Look with me. Verse 20 through 23. This is between you and the Lord. What comes out of the person is what defiles him. For from within, out of your heart, the heart of man, and evil thoughts, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, coveting. wickedness, deceit, sensuality, envy, slander, pride, foolishness. All these evil things come from within, and they defile a person. You see, we read a list like that, and it reminds us of what Jeremiah says in Jeremiah chapter 17. It informs us of a true diagnosis that our hearts are deceitful and desperately sick. Now, maybe you read that list and you're like, phew, I'm good, chapter. None of those got me. That's between you and the Lord. But if you want another book that can have like a colonoscopy effect on your life, I would encourage you to read Jerry Bridges' Respectable Sins. Right? Because sometimes you think, oh, those little sins don't really bother God. And they do. They matter. And they come from the heart. Jerry Bridges in that book says that sin is a spiritual and moral malignancy. Left unchecked, it can spread throughout our entire inner being and contaminate every area of our lives. So this book isn't going to let you be comfortable or cozy with any of the respectable sins that we are all guilty of. So, real quick, there's a diagnostic error that we focus on the external instead of the internal. We look to the wrong diagnosis, the wrong standard in our pride, in our presumption, in our need to search our own heart. What does this passage tell us about Jesus? And I'm going to go through these very quickly. First of all, Jesus values your heart. Again, Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 10. I, the Lord, search your heart. That's what he searches. Love the Lord your God with all of your heart. And as I say that, that should be a beautiful thing and a scary thing all at the same time. It's beautiful because Jesus is not content without having anything less than your heart. But it's a scary thing because he knows what's in that heart of yours. He values your heart. The other thing that this passage shows us is that Jesus values holiness. Yes, he's full of grace and mercy and compassion, but holiness still matters to him. In our culture, holiness gets such a bad rap. And even in the Christian church, holiness gets a bad rap. Oh, you're trying to be legalistic. No, no, holiness is such a beautiful thing. Holiness is such a glorious, righteous thing. And Jesus values it. He values it so much that he wants you to share in his holiness. Don't ever underestimate. Don't ever think that Jesus doesn't value holiness. He does. And we should too, because it is Jesus also values honesty. Listen, you may be able to fool others, but you cannot fool him. You cannot put this. Sometimes this lipstick on a pig thing, right? Sometimes, you know, we want to maybe impress others, but do you think Jesus is going to, like, stand by and be like, man, that Mark Wynn, he sure is a holy guy. Like, is he going to look? Really? Is he going to be, wow, Mark is so holy today. Really? No. He'd rather us just be honest. Lord, my heart is defiled. It's defiled. I need you to clean it. He values honesty, but he also values healing our hearts. So much of the Old Testament prophecies of Jesus talk about the work that he wants to do on our hearts, right? He wants to take away our hearts of stone, give us a heart of flesh. He wants to write the law of God in our hearts. And for those of you, right, for those of you who are struggling with backsliding, right, that's when you feel like a hypocrite, right? And it's not just every once in a while that there's a habit, sinfulness, brokenness. Jesus longs to heal our hearts of that in Isaiah 57, verse 17 and 18. But even though he went on backsliding in the way of his own heart, I have seen his ways. I will heal him. I will lead him and restore him. Comfort to him and his mourners, creating the fruit of the lips. Peace, peace to the far and near, says the Lord, and I will heal him. Jesus longs to heal us of the hypocrisy and the backsliding that is within our hearts, but we have to be honest with him about that. It's that saying about the Pharisee, that parable of the Pharisee and tax collector, right? The Pharisee goes, Lord, I'm glad I'm not like this sinner. I'm glad I'm not like this tax collector. I do so many religious things. And the tax collector, won't even look. Beats his breast. He says, Lord, have mercy on me, the sinner. Jesus said, it was him. It was him who went justified. It's him whose heart was right before the Lord. So if we would just honestly acknowledge, humbly confess our sin and our need for a righteousness not our own, this greatest change that Jesus has bore your defilement and blessed you with his righteousness, that's how you get and keep close to Jesus. So brothers and sisters, don't ignore your heart. Guard your heart and entrust your heart to
Let's pray together.
Almighty God, forgive us for our neglect. Forgive us for our presumption. Forgive us for our pride, for relying on our own religious rituals and not clinging to the very righteousness of Jesus. Presuming upon somehow that's something that I could do to heal my own heart or make my heart right before you. Oh, Father, forgive us for such fault. Lord, let us just see and taste the beauty of your holiness. We entrust our hearts to you. Heal us and rid us of all hypocrisy.
Great joy and great confidence because of
present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy. To the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, in glory, majesty, dominion, and authority, both now and forevermore. Amen. Please join us for fellowship.